This conference will now be recorded.
So, warm greetings from Sri Ishwa College of Engineering. I myself, J. Dhanashekar, working as Assistant Professor, Department of ECE. Hope you all are safe and secure. I welcome you all for this webinar on Machine Learning and Deep Learning organized by Networking Club, Department of ECE, Sri Ishwa College of Engineering. I'm happy to introduce our resource person. I'm proud to say that he is my student, Mr. Bharathi Kannan. I welcome you, Bharathi Kannan. He belongs to final year student, and he has wide knowledge in deep learning and machine learning concept. I'm proud to say that he has undergone a self-learning online course on the topic machine learning and deep learning, and he grasped many interesting ideas through that, and now he is going to share all those ideas with you people. Hope for next 1 hour he will be entertaining you with sharing his wonderful knowledge. Right now I hand over the session to Bharathi Kannan, and once again I welcome you all. And if you have any queries regarding the session, you can post it at the end. Last 10 minutes we will have question and answer session. Now I hand over the session to Bharathi Kannan. I wish you all a happy learning for next 1 hour. Bharathi Kannan?
Sir, am I audible?
Bharathi Kannan? Yeah, you are audible. Shall I make you as presenter?
Okay, sir.
Okay, Bharathi Kannan.
Okay, sir. Hello, everyone. I welcome you all to my webinar on machine learning and deep learning. I am Bharathi Kannan from final year ECEA. I'm from Sri Ishwar College of Engineering. Before starting the session, I would like to thank Sri Ishwar College of Engineering, ECE Department, Networking Club, and also all the staff and student coordinators for making this webinar possible. So now let's get into the session. So today's agenda will be introduction to machine learning algorithms. We will see about three types of machine learning algorithms: supervised, unsupervised, and also reinforcement learning. And we will also see about deep learning concepts. And we will also see about applications, and I will also introduce you to programming examples. First, before introducing machine learning, I will introduce you to about the artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence is a wide-ranging branch of computer science, which is mainly concerned about building smart systems that can capable of mimicking human intelligence. Artificial intelligence is nothing but mimicking human intelligence. There can be any techniques used to mimic human intelligence, but one of the most common preferred methods is called machine learning. So in this session we will be mainly seeing about machine learning, and deep learning is actually a part of machine learning. So an introduction to machine learning will be: machine learning is a field of study that gives computers the ability to learn without being explicitly programmed. It means that you will not hard code all of the features or patterns in the data to learn, because for any data like images of cat, there will be so many patterns in the data. So we will let the machine to learn its own patterns that we will actually struggle to discover the data. It means a pattern. So a more modern definition to machine learning will be, for any task T, the performance of a machine will increase with experience. You will actually understand why this definition actually works, and you will also understand how machine can learn from data. So now let's get into it. Why we need machine learning? So machines can do as a thinking entities. Like if we can see a cat and we can determine it is a cat. For any dog, we can also see a dog and we can see it can say it is a dog. So how can we program a computer to learn this data? So that's why we will let the machine to learn its own patterns from the data. So the solution will be, it will learn from previous data and will make predictions on the new data. So sometimes it can also overperform humans on some tasks. So the practical problems that is solved by machine learning is like digit recognition, like face detection while we are using in mobile phones, or speech understanding or natural language processing like Google Assistant, Amazon Alexa, and a product recommendation like Google or Amazon. So why is it so powerful? Suppose if you take a image like a dog, how can you code this an algorithm to classify it as a dog? Suppose if you compare it by pixel, what happens if you see a dog like a black dog? So here comes the actual problem. Even though if you have determined some patterns in this both of this data, and if you implement an algorithm, what will you do if you see a dog with a combination of both white, black and white? Here comes the actual problem. We can't define all of the patterns in the data, because we will even struggle to discover all of the patterns in a single data. Imagine the number of classes in a world. There can be dogs, cats, and trucks, cars. For each of the data, we need to define all of the patterns by ourselves. So, but it will be impossible to do for all of the things that we'll see in the world. So that's why we will let the machines to learn all of its patterns from the data. So even if we define an algorithm for these three, there are so many data that is available in the world. So it's very, very impossible for us to define an algorithm or define a pattern for an algorithm. So that's why we will let the machine to learn its own patterns from the data. So now let's get into the machine learning algorithms. There are three main types of machine learning algorithms. One is supervised learning, and one is unsupervised learning, and another one is reinforcement learning. You will see in depth in reinforcement learning, and also linear in that you will see in depth in linear regression. And you will also expand that knowledge into all of the others, because it will be similar to each other. So I have said there are three types of machine learning algorithms. So first is supervised learning. In supervised learning, there will be a supervisor. Imagine machine learning algorithm is like creating a baby. Suppose if you need a baby to classify a cat, you will give the baby, this is the cat, and this is, you will give the input, this is a cat. So it will learn some patterns in the data, and it will predict for new data. So there will be input the cat, and you will also say it is a cat. So that's why there will be labels in the supervised learning. But in unsupervised learning, there will be no labels. It means you will only give the input data, and you will train a machine learning algorithm to identify some patterns in the data. It means like clustering the data. Here we can see these are all similar to each other. So these are all classified as one output. So that's why in unsupervised learning, there will be no outputs. It will just find the patterns in the data. We will see in depth in reinforcement learning. But one thing you need to remember is, imagine if you are playing a Super Mario game, the input and outputs will be very, very large. The inputs will be every point in that environment, and the output will be in which direction you need to move. So it will be very, very hard for a programmer to define the input and output features. So we will let the algorithm to take actions, and we will reward them. Based on the reward, it will try to make good actions in the next step. So we will see about machine learning process. So first, the company will acquire raw data. So in raw data, there can be any mislabeled data or some kind of error in it. So the data first will be processed. So until we get the process data, we will process the data. And after processing the data, we will give it into the machine learning algorithm. 1 minute. So we will give it into the machine learning algorithm, and we will check whether if it gives the highest accuracy or not. Until it satisfies the highest accuracy, we will tune our model to give the highest accuracy. After it satisfies the accuracy, we will deploy our model. So the main thing the machine learning is applied here is we need to create a machine learning model that will mimic the human intelligence. So that's what we are going to see here. We are going to be creating a model for mimicking human intelligence. So the next will be, first we will see about supervised learning. I have said there are three types of machine learning algorithms: supervised, unsupervised, and also reinforcement learning. In supervised learning, there will be labeled data set. It means you will have both input and output features. So the example will be, if you are given the area of the house, you need to predict the price of the house. Imagine this is a input features. So there are only one feature, and you need to predict the price. The output will be only one feature, but there can be any inputs. Here we have area of the house. Based on the area of the house, we need to predict the price of the house. Now let's see its types. There are two types of supervised learning. One is regression and one is classification. In regression, the output will be continuous. As you have seen here, the output will be continuous. But in classification, the output will be discrete. So an example for regression will be, given a picture of a person, we need to predict his or her age. It means age will be continuous. So we can use regression. But in classification, you are given a picture of a person, but you need to predict their gender. You need to predict whether he or she is male or female. So the output is discrete. So you can use classification for these types of problem. So there are two types, regression and classification. You will see about regression. In regression, we will mainly use linear regression. As I said, I have increased the data. Based on the area, we need to predict the price. First, we will plot area versus price. So here we can see for 2500, it's giving 5500, and we will plot all of this in our data points. So what linear regression will do is, it will try to match a linear independent between inputs and outputs. It will try to predict a linear line, a linear relationship between input and output. So here we can see, this is the predicted output. Here we can see it is continuous. So as you know that the equation for the straight line is y equal to mx plus c. I will once again write it. Here y equal to, this is y and this is mx plus c. Sorry for handwriting, I am writing notes. So here we can see this is the mathematical equation for this line. So this will be the prediction for our output. So y equal to mx plus c. So this will be our output. This will be our prediction. Here we can see the original data point is here, but the original predicted will be here. So this is the error we need to minimize this. So here is a data point. Here is a linear regression. So this is the error that our algorithm will give. So our aim is to minimize this error to fit a linear line in this data point. So as I said, y equal to mx plus c. If you find the best weight and biases for the data, it means this line, you can use this weights and biases to predict for new data. So the new data will be any new data. So suppose you want to predict the price of the house for any area of 2800. You can use the pre-trained model of weights and biases to predict the new output. So this is how the linear regression works. So now I will introduce you to the visualization part in linear regression. Once again. I think you all can see this. So as I have said, y equal to mx plus c. So this is the weights that we need to optimize that, and this is the bias. So first I will show you how this will work. So we need to find the best weights and biases to fit this line. By adjusting this biases, you can see that slope of the line changes. By adjusting the bias, you can see the starting point changes. I think you all can see this. So you need to find the best weights and biases for the data that will fit all of the data points with the minimum error. So how can you find this? So this is what the linear regression is actually trying to address. I'll show you another visualization. I think you all can see this. So these are the three data points that we have. So Q, R, and also S. Suppose this is our line. This is what we are predicting. By adjusting the weights and biases, you can see the prediction will be changing. So our actual prediction will be this line. For any data points like 0.8, its original output will be 4.2. Here we can see that by adjusting the weights and biases, your bias is nothing but the slope. The slope is nothing but m. We will represent in mathematical equation as m. Y is equal to mx plus c. So by adjusting this weight, you can see that our prediction and also the data points will be changing. So our error will be this line. So we need to calculate the error for each of the data points. So you can see that by changing the weights, you can see it fits our data point. Here you can see that the original squared error. Once again. Here we can see that the total sum of squares. It means it is taking this point and is subtracting and it is squaring. So you can get this point, get this line, and this line and this line, and it will add all of this. That's our original cost. So we need to change this weights and biases such that it will give our minimum cost. So this is what the linear regression is actually trying to address. So now let's get back into our PPT. So for our model to get our highest accuracy, we need minimum cost function. So as I have said, we need to go through all of our data sets from 1 to m. For m is the total number of training examples, we will predict what is our output and the original output, and we will square them, and we will do it for all of our data sets, and we will take the mean error of it. So this is called a mean square error. So this is our cost function for a linear regression, and we need to minimize this cost function in order to get the best fit line. So m is the number of training examples, and this is the error. We will square this error in our cost function. So we have our hypothesis function. We need to find the best weights and biases such that it fits all of the data points correctly. So we have our cost function, and this is our equation. So our goal is to minimize the cost function. So how can you minimize this cost function? So one of the brute force method is to go through all of the weights and biases, and you need to check which one gives the minimum cost function. But this is actually expensive. There is another method called gradient descent to do this. So this is the gradient descent algorithm. One of the two things you need to remember this, it is, suppose if you are initializing your weights and biases at some point. So this is the point. So you can see that the cost function is actually 200. So you need to adjust your weights and biases so that you will get the minimum cost function. So this is the graph that is drawn for all of the weights and biases using brute force method. But we should not do this, but we need to actually insulate at some point, and we need to decide which direction you need to go and how much steps you need to make. So that is what the gradient descent algorithm is actually doing. So you will adjust your weights and biases by some learning rate. This learning rate alpha determines how much steps you need to come down, and this differentiation takes the slope of it, and it will say which direction you need to go. So we have our hypothesis function, we have our cost function. By using the gradient descent algorithm, we will apply it for biases. So we can see bias will be updated by bias minus learning rate. This determines how much steps you need to come down, and this is the slope of it. If you take the differentiation of this with respect to bias, square rule actually comes down, and it will actually cancel this two term, this two and this two. And if you take the inner product of it for bias, you will actually get to one. So this will be the same of this equation. The same will be applied for bias weight. If you change the weight equal to weight minus alpha, this alpha determines how much you need to come down in the weight axis, and this is the differentiation for weight. So if you apply this weights and biases for many iterations, you will actually minimize the cost function. I will also give you a programming example for this, and you can work it out in your own. I will give it after this session. So I will say how this gradient descent algorithm actually works. Suppose if you are taking some weights, imagine this weight is actually 10. So your cost function will be something like this. So your aim is to go down in this direction. So we need to take the slope of it. If you take the slope of it, it will actually gives minus, it will be negative. So it just assume that it is giving as negative 2. So if you give negative 2 here and learning rate alpha is 1. So imagine it is 2 minus 2 and learning rate alpha is 1. You are deciding that you need to take some steps. So if you 1 into minus 2 will be minus 2. So this will be for weights. So sorry, we can use it for here. Imagine alpha is 1, and if you're taking the slope, it will be around minus 2 for this point. So this is around 10. So the slope will be negative. So by taking the product of it, it will be 1 into minus 2 will be minus 2. Imagine 10 will be updated by 10 plus 2. So it will actually move down in this direction. So you can see that how gradient descent actually works. This alpha determines how much steps you need to make. If you apply 1, it will output as 12. If you apply 2, it will give 14. So in one step, how much you need to decrease will be determined by this alpha. So alpha is also called as hyperparameter, because there is no formula for getting alpha. So one of the best ways to apply alpha is to use different alpha values, and we need to check which one gives the maximum accuracy. So if you apply this for both weights and biases, you can actually decrease your cost function. So we will see for adding more features. In first linear regression, we have added only one feature, area of the house, and we need to predict the price of the house. So here there are two features. We will give area of the house, and we will also give age of the house. So we need to predict the price of the house. So given area of the house, given age of the house, and we need to predict the price. So our hypothesis will be, our prediction will be, we will add weights for the first feature and weights for the second feature, and we will also have the bias. If you train your algorithm using gradient descent, you will actually get the minimum cost for some weights, and also for weight one and weight two, and also for bias. So you can use those weights and biases for the new inputs. Suppose you want to predict the price of the house for this area and also this age, you can use this pre-trained model, that weights and biases, for your new prediction. So that's what it will learn from data, and it will predict for new data. That's what machine learning is actually doing. And I will also introduce to polynomial regression. Suppose if you are not able to fit a linear regression, that will minimize all of the cost. Because if you draw a linear line, there will always be some error in that. So you can't actually minimize that error, because it actually a straight line and there is no way to minimize that. So that only we will use polynomial regression. In polynomial regression, it will try to predict a polynomial, something kind of non-linear relationship between input and output. So this can be represented by, we will take the x and we will also square it. So this is the weight one and this is the weight two. By actually adding polynomial term, you can actually bend the curve like this. So you can add any number of polynomial features for the same area or any other features. Suppose if you are trained an algorithm and you can use this pre-trained weights for getting outputs for new data. So you can get the weights and you can apply new input, predict the price for the house for 2800 area, and you will also square it, and you will get your prediction output. So this is the polynomial regression. So now let's get into logistic regression. So logistic regression is a classification problem. As I said, in supervised learning, there are two types, regression and classification. This logistic regression is a classification problem. In classification problem, we are trying to address only zero, or it means we are trying to address only discrete values. So the examples would be, we are given the email and we need to predict whether it is spam or not, or whether a person has win or lose, or pass or fail. So this is what the logistic regression is actually doing. Our outputs will be zero or one. It will be binary. Only classification, logistic regression will classify only zero or one. Instead of using a logistic linear regression for classifying this as zero or one, we can use something called logistic regression. The curve will something look like this. I will actually explain it. Suppose if you are given an area and also the price, you need to determine whether it will sell or not. So for this area and this price, this house will sell. So zero means it will not sell, and one means it will sell. So our hypothesis will be the same as we have seen in linear regression. We need to adjust our weight one and weight two for our x1 will be here and x2 will be here. We need to predict our weight one and weight two, and also our bias. So this will be our hypothesis. But as we have seen, that it can be continuous and it can range from any value. But in logistic regression, it should be 0 to 1. So what we can do is, we can apply the z to something called sigmoid. The sigmoid will take care of that. For every z, it will always be in the range 0 to 1. So this is how. If your z is less than 0.5, we can classify all of this as 0. If it is greater than 0.5, we can classify all of this as 1. So this is how you can use logistic regression to classify either as 0 or 1. So how can you use it for multiple classes? If you're having classes hen, cat, and dog, how can you use this to classify these two? Because as I said, logistic regression can only classify 0 or 1. So a technique can be used, something called one-with-solve. In one-with-solve, we can train three different types of logistic regression. In first logistic regression, it will try to classify this as hen or not. In second, it will try to classify it as cat or not. In third, it will try to classify it as dog or not. So this will say it is hen or not, this will say it is cat or not, and this will say it is dog or not. So this is how it will try to classify. So here we have three classes. Instead of training the same For a single logistic regression, we will train three different logistic regression. It will try to say, first one will try to say it is hen or not. Second one will try to say whether it is cat or not. Third one will try to say whether it is dog or not. So what if you have new input like a dog? So the first logistic regression will output zero because our input is hen, but our input is dog. So it will actually output zero. If you give this input to this logistic regression, it will also output zero. But if you apply this input to this logistic regression, it is trained to predict it as a dog. So it will output one. So if you take a maximum index of it, imagine this logistic regression is class one and this is class two and this is class three. If you take the maximum index of it, you can actually get which class is it. It is, you can see it is class three and you have actually identified it as class three. This is new dog. So, and I will also introduce to regularization. So what is regularization is, you can use any type of polynomial features to fit all of these data points like this. You can see. So we can use any type of polynomial regression to classify data points like this, and it will also give the minimum cost function, but it will only perform well on training data, but it will not perform on test data, because our aim is not to minimize this cost function, but also to generalize our data. It means your aim is only to generalize for all of this data, not only to fit all of the data. That's why we will add something called regularization term to this. So here is a original loss function, or hypothesis minus original output squared, and this is the original loss function as we have seen in linear regression. In that term, we will add something called lambda. This lambda is also hyperparameter. In hyperparameter, there is no way to find this lambda, because for every data set it will vary. So you need to apply so many lambda parameters that gives the best accuracy. So here is a data set, and if you have used some polynomial regression with all of these data points, you can see it gives minimum error, but our original aim is to fit all of this data. That means generalize all of this data. So if this is zero, lambda is zero, it is actually our loss function, and it will overfit our data. If you increase our lambda to 10, it will move from overfit to optimal. And if you increase it 10 to 1000 or any other value, it's like increasing the lambda, it will also go to underfit the data. So you need to optimally choose this lambda parameter such that it generalizes all of this data. So this is underfitting our data, this is overfitting our data. By using regularization, we can try to generalize our data. So this is called bias versus variance trade-off. You need to optimally choose lambda such that it generalizes all of our data. So an advice for applying machine learning. Imagine this is our input, predicting the price for a house. So I have taken two inputs and two outputs, and you have trained your algorithm such that it gives two and two for bias and weights. I have added one here for simplicity. If you are using Python for implement this, you will actually take this term and you will multiply it with bias. As you have seen that this is our cost function, because multiplying this and this will give the same bias. And you will, in the next step only, you will take x1 and you will take weight to do this. But it is not efficient for very, very large data set and many features. That's why we will use something called vectorization. If you need to implement vectorization in Python, you can actually use NumPy. NumPy will does the vectorization for you. In NumPy, it will consider the input as a matrix. So if you consider this as a matrix, you will have two, this is two and this is two. So if you have two rows and two columns, here there are only one column. So here are two rows and one column. If you take the dot product of it, it will actually 2 by 2 into 2 by 1, you will actually get 1 by 1 vector. So this one. Instead of doing this for using normal multiplication, non-vectorized implementation in Python, we can actually consider this as a matrix such that this process, and this process and this process can be done in parallel, because it is not going to affect any of our data. And we will actually minus it with the original output. That is what here actually doing in vectorized implementation. We will take the dot product of x and theta, and we will actually minus it with y. Here we can see that the cost function is implemented in vectorized implementation. So the next step you need to do is square all of this. So that is what here in vectorized implementation you are doing. You are actually squaring all of this. And then you need to take the sum of it. So that can be implemented by np.sum. This equation will take care of all of this cost function for you. If you are not using vectorized implementation, you need to actually do all of these codes to do the single cost function. So that's a vectorized implementation will do all of the process parallelly. And you can also see that it can actually do it in very, very fast manner. It means if you can able to do this in 100 hours, if you use vectorized implementation using NumPy, you can actually finish it in 1 hour. So that's how fast is vectorized implementation. And another advice for applying machine learning is splitting our data. Suppose if you have 100 data, you will only train your model by using only 60% of the data. So we need to predict the perfect weights and biases using only 60% of the data. And why we need cross-validation set and test set? As I have said that we have alpha and lambda. So these are the hyperparameters. There is no way to identify this alpha and lambda by using formula. So we need to use many alpha and lambda parameters, say in range like 10 alpha parameters and 10 lambda parameters. So you need to pick the best alpha and lambda values that will give maximize the accuracy. So that's why we will use something called validation set. You will try your different alpha and lambda values that gives the best accuracy. So we will choose our alpha and lambda values, and our original accuracy will be determined by using test set. Because if you use this accuracy, if it gives us 95, for example, if it gives 95% accuracy, it means that alpha and lambda is actually overfitting our validation test set. So that's why we will use something called test set to predict our original accuracy. So now let's say into second type. As I said, there are three types of supervised learning. There are three types of machine learning algorithms: supervised, unsupervised, and reinforcement learning. This is the second type, unsupervised learning. In unsupervised learning, we have no or little idea about how our outputs will look like. As I have said that we don't know how our outputs will look like, but our only thing is to, we need to categorize all of this data. Can be used for social network analysis or astronomical data analysis. Suppose if you need to segment your customers, you can choose these are all one clusters and these are all one clusters and these are all one clusters. So your only thing is to find some patterns in this data. You need to cluster all of this data. A best example would be if you see any YouTube video, you can get recommendations. So how it is happening actually? Suppose consider this as a YouTube video. If you're watching this YouTube video, what are the YouTube videos that will be recommended to you? What are the similar data to this YouTube video? Imagine this YouTube video and this YouTube video are similar. So it is clustered. So you will get all of the recommendations in this set. So this is how the YouTube recommendation or recommender systems work. And it can be used in astronomical data analysis. There can be huge number of data. We only need to cluster those data so that we can find some patterns in the data. So that is what supervised learning is trying to address it. It will try to find some patterns in the data. So imagine if you have some data and you don't know what are outputs actually are. So your only thing is to cluster this data. So how can you cluster this data? You can see these are all on clusters and these are all on clusters and these are all on clusters. So how can you cluster this data? So we will use something called k-means algorithm. In k-means algorithm, you will actually implement some centroids. You can choose any number of any centroid in any place. You can randomly choose this centroid. The centroid can be randomly chosen and it is placed here. And the centroid is chosen and placed here. And this cluster centroid is chosen and it is placed here. So in order to cluster all of this data, it's actually clustered in number one, but actually there are no classes like this described here. So first you will take some centroid points and you will assign all of the data points that is nearer to this cluster. You can see these are all the data points that is nearer to this centroid point. You can see these are all the data points that is nearer to this cluster. So these are all assigned as red. And you can see these data points are closer to this point. So these are all assigned as one cluster. And you can see for this cluster, these are all nearer to this. So the next step you need to do is for this centroid, these are all the data points that is assigned. So you will actually take the mean of all of these data points that is assigned to it. One is So if you take the mean of it, it actually moves from here to here. It means the mean for all of these data points will look something like here, not this. So in the next step of k-means algorithm, we'll actually move the data point from here to here. If you repeat the step by taking the mean for all of the data points assigned to some cluster, and if you assign, change the center point, you will actually end up in some clusters. You can see it started from here and it tried to update its centroid points and it actually reached the cluster. So it will actually try to cluster all of the data points. Here we can see these are all the data points clustered, and these are all the data points clustered, and these are all data points that are clustered. So it will try to find some patterns in the data. It does not need to say what our outputs are, but it will try to identify these are all same and these are all same and these are all same. So that is what the unsupervised learning is trying to address it. So a best example would be, if you are given an image, how can you compress an image without even reducing the number of pixels in it? Suppose if you have 250 pixels and 150 pixels in it. So there are 250 by 150 pixels, and for each pixel we will represent by RGB value. So for each R it will take 8 bits. So for green it will also take 8 bits. For B also it will take 8 bits. So there will be total number of 24 bits for representing a single color. So the total number of bits will be around 9 lakh. So how can you reduce it? So first I will say about how clustering is done. You can use k-means algorithm. Choose 8 number of centroid points. If you update your centroid points at some random value, and if you try to update your centroid point, it will actually cluster all of the similar outputs here. You can see these are all similar to each other. So these are all can be clustered, and this can be represented by a single cluster value. So if you use k is equal to 8, there will be 8 cluster centroids. So instead of representing 24 bits for representing a color, since we have only 8 colors, we can represent this it by 2 to the power 3 equal to 8. So there only 3 bits can be used to represent this dictionary. So instead of representing by 24 bits for this any pixel, we can use just 3 bits for representing a pixel. So if you use this algorithm, it will actually minimize it to 112,692 bits. So you can see how efficient it is. I will also give a link for this so that you can actually see how it works. I will give a link in the repository. So this is how the image is compressed. You can see the original image is this, and if you cluster it with such 16 centroids, you can see these are all similar to each other. So these can be clustered and they can be represented by a single color. You can see these are all similar to each other. So these can be clustered and they can be represented by just, for k equal to 16, we will use 4 bits to represent all of these colors instead of representing it by 24 pixels. So this is how efficient it is. If you use 8 clusters, you can see there are only 8 colors in this image. If you use 4 clusters, there are only 4 colors in this. If you use 2 centroids, you can see only there are 2 colors in this one color and this one color. There are only 2 colors to represent this image. And for one, there is only 1 color to represent this image. So you can see by also using k equal to just 16 colors, we can also represent the image with high quality. So this is how the image can be compressed without even reducing the number of pixels in the image by using unsupervised learning. So the third type I need to explain is reinforcement learning. So what is reinforcement learning trying to address is, first I will say it with an example. So first I will try it with an example. Suppose if you are playing a mobile game for the first time, imagine it is a car race. So how can you decide which direction you need to go and what are the steps you need to make? So if you train it with a supervised algorithm, the inputs will be every point in the space. Suppose if you are training an algorithm for self-driving cars, the inputs will be every point in the road and the output will be which direction you need to go. But it is actually impossible to do this. So that's why we will let an algorithm to make its own actions. Based on these actions, we will actually reward it. The reward can be the maximum score. The maximum score, if you are playing a game, if you are reaching the maximum score, you will be rewarded with the maximum score. And if you are actually getting out, you will be punished. So based on this, it will try to recognize some pattern in them such that it will can get maximum reward. It can be mainly used in games, self-driving cars, training a drone. Imagine if you need to train a drone with a supervised learning, the inputs will be all of the points in the space and your outputs will be which direction you need to go. But it's actually impossible to give all of the inputs like this. So that's why we will use something called reinforcement learning. You will let the system to make its own. You will let the system to make its own predictions. Based on that, we will actually reward them. We will reward them with the maximum highest score, or we will punish them if it does any wrong mistakes. So this is how the reinforcement learning actually works. So best example would be Google Atari Breakout. Google has developed an Atari Breakout game. I will actually play the video. So in this Atari game, I will show you. In this Atari game, this reinforcement learning tried to predict that if we dig a hole here, it tried to learn that we can maximize the score. So it has played for around 600 rounds and it determined that by digging a hole, it can maximize its score. But even if we played for around 1000 times, it will be very, very difficult for us to learn this type of pattern. So that's why machines can learn some underlying very, very complex pattern in some data. So this is a Google Atari Breakout developed by Google. And there is also another application called Google DeepMind AlphaGo. In AlphaGo, there will be 19 by 19 board. And the number of possible moves in this AlphaGo is around 10 to the power 170. 10 to the power 170 is more than the number of atoms in the universe. It's actually believed that we can't actually design an algorithm that can beat a human level. But in 2014, Google DeepMind has developed AlphaGo, which beat the Lee Sedol. He's 18-time world champion in Go game. But this AlphaGo just trained for only 40 days and beat this Lee Sedol, who is 18 times world champion. It's actually incredible. You can actually watch this documentary here. It will be around 1.5 hours. It will be both fascinating to watch because, and you will also be worried that machines are actually trying to do all of the things that humans can do. So I will give you a link for this. You can actually watch this. And the next will be around reinforcement learning hide and seek game by Google. I will not play this video. I will give you a link in my GitHub repository. So I have explained you three types of machine learning algorithms: supervised, unsupervised, and reinforcement learning. The next thing we will see about is deep learning. Why we need deep learning if we have these types of machine learning algorithms? So I will say, what is deep learning? Deep learning is completely based on artificial neural networks. You can see we know that our brain consists of neurons. Each neurons are connected to each other such that each neuron will try to predict some, take some data, and it will process some data. So that is what we are going to mimic it. We will use going to mimic our human. So if you can see that if we have more data, our traditional ML algorithms or other algorithms will not increase its performance. So that's why we will use neural networks. If you use even a small neural network, your performance will increase. If you use medium neural network, your performance can be even increased. And if you use very large neural networks, your performance can even be increased. I will show you an example. 1 minute. I think you all can see this. So this is a TensorFlow playground. You can actually do this. So here we have two inputs. Imagine this is our data point. How can you classify this? These are all blue points and these are all orange points. What is the algorithm that you can use to classify this? Because it is highly non-linear, you can't use like linear regression or logistic regression for 0 to 1. But how can you classify this? So that's why we will use neural networks. Neural networks can be used for very, very complex or non-linear data. So we can actually train our data. We will use some learning rate alpha. This determines how much steps you need to make. And activation functions, you can use sigmoid. There are also many activation functions that you can use, but we will now mainly see about sigmoid. So if you take a neural network, you can see it is trying to classify these outputs. So that's how neural networks are trying to classify. Even by 68 IPO, IPO means going through all of the data sets. It's same as iterations. How many times you need to implement gradient descent? So by updating the weights. So for every gradient descent, it will update its weight to predict this. So for 68 gradient descent steps, it try to classify these are all blue and these are all red. So that's why neural networks are very, very powerful. These neural networks can be used for very, very complex data. So another data can be like this. How can you classify these are all orange and these are all blue? You can use neural networks. You can see it's trying to classify these are all blue and these are all orange. So that's why neural networks are very, very powerful for very, very complex and non-linear data. You can see if you have these types of data, you can't use any linear regression or logistic regression or some other types of machine learning algorithms. That's why neural network is very, very powerful. I'll just leave it for around 1000 IPO. You can see it try to classify all of these. It's trying to classify this. It will take some time to classify this, but you can see this blue coming towards here, and this is all classified as blue. The intensity represents how much probability that it thinks that it is blue. That's why it's very, very low. I will just simply leave it for just 1 minute. I think it can take time to classify all of this, but if you can implement it, you can just go to Google Chrome and you can search tensorflow.playground.tensorflow. You can actually go to this page and you can actually implement some layers like this and you can play with neural networks. So now I will go to the slide. So this is the architecture of neural network that we have seen in. Now you can see this slide. 1 minute. I think now you can see this slide. So this is the neural network structure that you have seen in TensorFlow playground. So this is a normal neuron, like a unit in a hidden layer. These are hidden layers. Instead of using a single logistic regression, this plays a single logistic regression. Imagine you have inputs coming towards it and you are using weights. So this is same as a single logistic regression. You are stacking a bunch of logistic regression in a single hidden layer, and you can use any hidden layers you want. You can see there are two hidden layers, and you will see weights are coming towards this, and this will act as a single logistic regression. This can be explained here. You can see x and weights are multiplied, and these are given to some activation function. This activation function can be sigmoid, as we have seen in logistic regression, until it will give some output. So if you give this output, it will process in the second layer. So how this actually works, I will show you with an example. Okay, I think you can see this. Imagine if you want to do a digit recognition, how can you classify this as 5 or this as 0 or this as 4? So one way to do is using logistic regression, using neural networks. So there will be 26 by 26 pixel image. So if you multiply it, there will be 2784 features. So you will implement all of these features as input to this neural network, and you will use some 15 neurons. So what each neuron will try to predict is, if you all can see this. So each neuron will try to predict some patterns in this. Imagine this neuron is trying to predict some pattern like this. So imagine this neuron is trying to predict some pattern like this, and this neuron is trying to predict some pattern like this. So each neuron will be trying to predict some patterns in the data. So this is how instead of training a single logistic regression to identify all of the features, we will use each logistic regression to classify its own features. So you can see. This neuron is actually trying to predict this kind. Pattern, and this neuron actually is trying to predict this kind of pattern. So if you combine these two features and these weights are mainly activated, these two features can be used to predict zero. So that's why you predict all of them, such that if I have a pattern like this, some neuron combine all each of. So that's why high non-linear data. So the next type of neural network is convolutional neural network. So I will go to this example. Imagine if you have a 1000 by 1000 pixel image, how can you use a normal neural network? Imagine if you have a 1000 by 1000 pixel image, the number of features will be around 1 million. So if you have 1 million inputs, so the number of weights associated will be around, if you have 15 neurons, it will be around 15 million weights. So you need to adjust all of these 15 million weights and biases to predict the output. But it is actually very expensive. So that's why we will use something called convolutional neural network. This convolutional neural network is very, very powerful for image type of data. So you will take something like filter and you will apply this filter like this here. So you can see this type of filter can be applied to this data and will try to predict some output here. So this can be moved one pixel here and same can be used here. So this is how the convolutional neural network is actually doing. So far, if you take the element wise product for all of this and if you sum all of this, you will get actually one output. So this is the output for one neuron. See, this is one neuron and this is another neuron. So this can, and these two produces two different outputs. These two can be combined to produce the output of the activation function. So this is how the convolutional neural network actually works. It will use some filters in the data and it will try to predict some patterns. Each convolutional filter can be used to predict some unique patterns. Imagine if you are using neural networks, you will have around 15 million weights and biases. So here we can see around 3 by 3 by 3, there are only 27 features associated with it. Why this is actually useful is, imagine if you're trying to predict some vertical edge here, the same filter can be used to predict some vertical edges here. So that's why we use convolutional neural network. The main importance and why this is efficient is it will do something called parameter sharing. If you are using some convolutional filter for predict some pattern in some part of the data, the same can be used in another part of the data to predict the pattern. So if you use convolutional neural network for the first activation layer, you can get some outputs like this. In the second, you can get something like this. This pooling layer is actually minimizing the number of features in this. I will explain this with an Excel example. If you do this convolutional layer and pooling layer for this is a single active new unit, and this convolution and pooling layer is the second unit, and you can actually convert this into a fully connected layer. This fully connected layer is nothing but our actual neural network. I will explain. So this is the fully connected layer. So we can convert into a normal neural network and we can try to classify it as something 0 to 1. So the number of weights will be very, very minimum. So that's why it can be useful for image types of data. So imagine if you have data something like 7. So you, instead of using weights for each of these features, we can use only 3 by 3 features. So this features is mainly gives weights to horizontal edges. You can see if you apply this convolutional filter like this, it will produce output here, and you can change one pixel here and you can take here and you can produce a second output. You can see this is mainly concerned for producing horizontal edges. So if you apply this for all of the features in the images, it will actually produce horizontal edges. So that's why convolutional filters are very, very useful for image types of data, and we can use any number of filters. So the main part in convolutional neural network is we should not hard code all of these features. We will let the machine to learn its own features from the data. So that's why it will learn some very, very complex features that we will struggle to discover. So that's why these neural networks are very, very powerful. So the applications of machine learning can be applied to many applications. Even Google, Facebook, Amazon, every big company uses machine learning. Even Google or Amazon knows more about you than your friends. They can suggest you some movies, songs, or anything. Even your friends don't know you like this. So that's why machine learning is very, very powerful for learning some complex pattern in the data. Can be used for facial detection. In facial detection in phone, you can see something like bounding box in front of your face. It's actually implemented in convolutional neural network and virtual personal assistant, social media service like recommendations, or spam filtering, or product recommendations is mainly by unsupervised learning. So this is the applications of machine learning. And I will also show you a programming example using linear regression. So I will give you this link. You can use this link to view all of the course materials I have discussed in a text script. One second. So this is the link I have provided. I will give you this link in the after this webinar. You can actually go to this link and you can see all of the files that I have provided to you. So these are the files I have shown you. First, I will show you image compression. So here is the image compression. So here I have the original image. With k is equal to 1 clustering, you can see there is only one image, one color. For k is equal to 2, you can see there is only two colors. I will give you the original files. You can actually download it and you can visualize it. I will take the original image. 1 minute. You can see the original image is around 128 KB. I think you all can see that the original image is around 128 KB. But if you compress it with around k is equal to 8 clusters, you can see the image is actually compressed. It's around 128 KB is converted to 27.8 KB. So the next file will be, I will show you linear regression. I actually implemented linear regression using scikit-learn library. You will see something like frameworks like TensorFlow, scikit-learn. Why we even need some libraries like TensorFlow or scikit-learn? I have seen you some of the mathematical terms behind linear regression and logistic regression. Do you need to implement it from scratch every time you build a new network? So that's why we will use this framework. These frameworks have already implemented all of the maths that is needed for you. You only need to import its function. So I have also implemented linear regression from scratch. All of the mathematical terms that you have seen will be implemented in Python. And I also given you NumPy. NumPy will do the vectorization for you. And here is the PPT. You can actually download this PPT and you can use it. And here is the README. This README contains all of the files that you need. Everything that I have said will be in the written script. If you need to learn or brush up your skills, you can actually come here anytime and you can learn everything. Here I have given you introduction to artificial intelligence, the machine learning. Everything will be in written script. You can come here anytime and you can view this. I will also introduce to you mathematical terms. Here I will also give introduction to cost function, gradient descent. Everything I have said will be in this written script, and I have also implemented in Python. The mathematical term I have introduced you, I have implemented in Python. So if you wish to implement in Python, you can come here and you can actually implement it. If you need the Jupyter notebook, I have implemented it in here. You can actually download this file and you can use it for your own purposes. You can use any data for fitting the linear regression line. So you can see by implementing it. So this is a original data. I think you all can see that. These are the data I have shown you. I have implemented in Python. So by using cost function and gradient descent, you can actually get a line like this. So this is a cost function. And there are everything you need will be here. Can actually come here anytime and you can view this. I will give a link for this here. I think you all
have got the link. You can use this link to view all of the materials that I have provided. I think you have received the link.
Bharati Kannan?
Sir?
Bharati Kannan? They have received the link, Bharati Kannan.
Can you hear, sir? Okay, sir.
Yes, Bharati Kannan. Link was received.
Okay.
And should okay, we have sir. A feedback now from participant side?
Okay, sir.
Okay.
You can ask any questions to
If you have any question, you can ask to Bharati Kannan and you can also provide your feedback.
Good evening all. I myself am Anish from 4th ECE. Well, I am very proud to deliver a vote of thanks for this wonderful webinar on machine learning and deep learning. First, I would like to thank our management and networking club of ECE department for giving this wonderful opportunity of bringing students' talent in delivering a lecture to students' community. My sincere thanks to our resource person, Mr. Bharati Kannan, for sharing his thoughts in machine learning and deep learning. We thought machine learning and deep learning will be difficult, but you made it a very easy one. Also, I extend my heartfelt thanks to all those who participated in webinar from various institutions all over the globe, and I hope we all benefited by this webinar. Thank you for participating in such a wonderful webinar, and we can meet you all in next webinar series, a Blaze Students webinar series from next week. Thank you. Stay home and stay safe.